because he's not bodily present with us. He's with us in spirit. And our frame of reference and understanding everything is things that we can see and touch and so on. What's it going to be like? You know, him who has loved us and gave himself for us, whom we know but have never seen, what that meeting is going to be like. Well, it's something to think about. One of these days soon we'll see him. I'd like for you this evening, turn with us to the book of Exodus. My readings and studying for our Sunday school and then devotion been in the book of Exodus. As I read this portion of scripture, there were some things that struck me, and I want to share these thoughts with you this evening. Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32, and we want to read verses 1 through 6. We have made reference to this when the children of Israel had come up out of Egypt. They'd come to Mount Sinai. God had spoken to them, and Moses had gone up onto the mount where God was instructing him. He was giving him the Ten Commandments, and he was instructing in those things and the tabernacle and all these other things that God was telling Moses about. Moses was up there for 40 days, 40 nights. Chapter 32, verse 1. And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not, or know not, what is become of him. And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives and of your sons and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people break off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received them at their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. When Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. And they rose up early on the morrow and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Especially verse 6 there where they brought an offering and they sat down to eat and drink and then rose up to play. But as I was thinking about these things, there was a number of things that come to mind. And one is how quickly our fleshly old nature will reassert itself if we do not take heed to ourselves. Within a very short time, and we think about the time when the children of Israel had been in bondage in Egypt. These people here had been in bondage all their lives, except for this brief period of time now since they've come up out of there. But we see how that they had witnessed when God came to them in Egypt and laid plague after plague after plague upon the Egyptians. 10 plagues culminating with the death of the firstborn. And these people saw all of this. And God led them out of Egypt, parted the Red Sea where they went across on dry ground, with these great heaps of water on either side. And they went across that night, and Pharaoh pursued after them, and they saw the waters come back and destroy Pharaoh and his army, and some other things there in the wilderness on the way to Mount Sinai. They had seen all these things. They had experienced it. They were there. Now Moses, they'd come to the mountain, and here they'd seen this great mountain. They'd seen the smoke and fire come down, the lightnings and thunderings, and God had spoken to them from the mount, and they quaked and did exceedingly fear, and they went back, and they said, don't let him speak to us anymore. You go up there and let him tell you, and then you come down and tell us, but don't let him speak to us anymore. See, that was just, it was too terrible. And so Moses goes up on the mount, and he's up there for 40 days, 40 nights. When you're sitting down there with nothing to do, perhaps that seems like a long time. That's not quite a month and a half. But nevertheless, in that time, it seems they forgot all about God. I was noticing as I was reading these verses, they make no mention of him. I mean, they're right there at the base, camped at the base of the mountain, and the cloud and the thunder and light still up there. Well, we see that they felt God had abandoned them. They were ready to strike out on their own. But one of the important things that for us to take from this is the warning and learn that we are really no different than these people. How many times we point out, you know, human nature hasn't changed. This is recorded for our benefit. Why? Because we do the same thing. Now I want us to look at three points, if you will, that I drew from this. Three stages of their departure from God and descent into worldly worship. And that's kind of the title of our message, the thought of our message this evening is worldly worship. And how the children of Israel so quickly came into this condition. By worldly worship, I mean any worship that is not the true worship of the true God. Now the first thing we notice in verse 1, when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mountain. Couple of things here. When the people saw, they were walking by sight, not by faith. As God's people, we are to walk by faith, not by sight. And they were using their, I believe here, their reference to their natural reasoning, their senses, their sight, and so on. They saw that Moses delayed coming down out of the mountain. And that's an interesting concept. It's an interesting point. Moses delayed coming down. Moses didn't delay. God wasn't finished teaching him yet. You ever stop thinking about that? Moses went up there to meet with God. He wasn't going to come down until God was finished with him. He didn't sit around, you know, it wasn't like God had him up there for 10 days and was done, and Moses sat around up there on his own for 30 days. God was still working with him and teaching him and wasn't ready for him to come down yet. He was not delaying to come down, but that was their perception of it because they were walking by sight and they were leaning to their own understanding. Well, Proverbs said, lean not to thine own understanding. You know, trust in the Lord. Moses hadn't come down yet. God's still teaching him something, still speaking to him. Need to trust the Lord. Second Corinthians chapter 5, several verses of scripture here. And to see how this does pertain then, as we take this Old Testament event and how the lessons we can garner from it pertain to us today and as churches of the Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 7. He says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Romans 8. Verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So we're not to lean to our fleshly understanding. We're not to walk according to our sight these things, but we're to walk after the Spirit. Verse 4. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Then 1 Corinthians 3:3. Paul says, for ye are yet carnal, whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men? So we see this, the fleshliness, walking after the flesh, walking by sight. Because we're in the flesh, it is very natural for us. There is a strong tendency for us. And that's the reason I'm saying, if we're not careful, if we're not taking heed to ourselves, it is very easy for us to do the same thing, to fall into the same mistakes that the children of Israel did, and that's why they are there to be an example to us. Now in Hebrews chapter 10, Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 36 and 37, notice what Paul says here. It says, for ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, you might receive the promise. So you have need of patience. He said, for yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. Now, Jesus said he will come. He made that promise in the Gospel of John. I go and prepare a place for you. I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. He's made that promise. We look forward to that promise. Peter talks about in the last days, scoffers will arise and say, well, where is the promise of his coming? That was 2,000 years ago and he hadn't come yet. Where is the promise of his coming? But he also says there in 2 Peter chapter 3, God is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. See, there again, there's that God's time and our time. You know, do we lean to the flesh? Do we perceive time, you know, from our fleshly understanding? Or are we considering God and what his timing might be? And he has a different perception of time. And we need to be more concerned with his time. I will kind of come back to it, but in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, he said, and I don't want you to be ignorant of this fact, But 1,000 years is as a day with the Lord. And a day is 1,000 years. He said, you know, what he's saying is, what for us down here, 1,000 years, that's a long time. He's, but you have to understand, God is eternal. It's to him no more than a day. What would be a day to us? But 1,000 years with us is as a day with the Lord. You need to keep that in mind. So God is not slack concerning his promises, some men count slackness. But now notice in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 24, and Jesus, the whole context here, his return and different things, they've asked him, you know, in chapter 24, verse 3, they said, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? And so Jesus is discussing these things with them. But notice what he says here in verse 48. You know, he talks about the faithful servant. To be ready, to watch. Now let's back up and read that. Verse 44. Therefore be ye also ready. For in such an hour as ye think not, the Lord, Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. And so kind of allusion there to some of his previous parables and lessons about the talents and all. He says, now look, I've given you a work to do. Well, I'm gone. Now that faithful servant, that good and faithful servant, when he comes back, he's going to find him doing that work that he gave him to do. But now the opposite of that, he picks up with verse 48. But, and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming. There it is. You know, there's that same attitude we see in the Hebrew children there at the base of Mount Sinai. Moses had been up there for 40 days. And they said, look, he delayeth his coming. We don't know what's happened to him. We need to take matters into our own hands, you know. And so that evil servant said, my heart, Lord delayeth his coming, and he shall begin to smite his fellow servants, and to eat, and to drink, and to be drunken. Wait a minute. That sounds similar to what we read there about the children of Israel there, when they made the golden calf, and they came and they brought offerings, burnt offerings, and peace offerings. They sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. Why? The Lord hadn't come back yet. Oh, and so there's a lot of things that we can see that is happening today that I believe is a result, this very attitude and all present in our society, present in our churches, present in professed Christianity today, and it's following the very things that we're warned about here in the Scriptures. So when we walk after our fleshly senses, walk by sight, we're bound to apply fleshly wisdom. James talks about this wisdom doesn't come from above, but it's earthly, it's sensual. That is, it has to do with our physical senses. And he says, and it's devilish. And when we do this, it's disastrous results. One of the things we need to see, and it's easier for us in some ways to look and read that in Exodus about the children of Israel and think, well, you know, 40 days, that's not that long. It doesn't make any difference if it's 40 days or 40 years. We're to wait upon the Lord. We're to trust in Him. And again, here they were, they didn't know what was going on up there in the mount. They couldn't see it. You know, the cloud was still there and everything, but they didn't know what was going on up there. And people have a tendency to get impatient. They want to see results. And God doesn't do things on our time. And when you think about it, and think about what Peter said there, that 1,000 years is one, you know, one day. Well, if 1,000 years of our time is one day with the Lord, what would 40 days of our time be to Him? You know, that's nothing. A few seconds. We need to learn patience. We need to learn to wait upon the Lord. Galatians, Paul said, let us not be weary in well-doing. You know, the Lord has given us something to do. He's given us, see, in one sense, we have an advantage over them. They hadn't been given anything to do yet. Now, we've been given a work to do. And we need to be about the Master's work and not to grow weary in doing the right thing and doing those things He's taught us to do. Day in, day out, week after week, month after month, year after year, He's given us a work to do. And we have need of patience, He said. And then we will be rewarded when He comes back. See, we'll reap in due season. Due season, He will return and He will reward His people and judge the earth. In due season. And one of the things, you know, He tells us there and that we might encourage one another. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, talk about forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is. In other words, He says, it has become the habit of some to forsake the assembly. He says, stop doing that. Literally, the grammar, the construction of that sentence is they were already starting to do it, and He's saying, stop. He's not warning them, don't get into the habit. He said, you're developing that habit, you need to stop it. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, and so much the more as you see that day approaching. And I think this is one of the things that we can do, you know, as time has lagged on, but as we see that day approaching, He has given us some signs. He's given us some things to go by, to as a signpost, if you will, to let us know we're getting close to the end. And I believe we see that. We're certainly closer to His return than we were 2,000 years ago. And so much the more. And we come together and we exhort one another and we encourage one another. Those are the things He's talking about there in Hebrews that we're to do. To stir one another up to love and to encourage one another, provoke one another. Not in a bad sense, but to encourage ourselves to do the right thing. Lest we become discouraged. You know, it is hard. And the Lord knows the weaknesses of the flesh and the difficulties we face. He knows our frame. He knows our weaknesses. But He doesn't excuse us from doing the right thing. That's why He is willing to come alongside and to help us, to strengthen us, to encourage us. It doesn't excuses, but He takes a note of that and provides help for us as we have need. The second thing that we see here is a result of their fleshly wisdom. they corrupted the worship of God. He said, make us gods. He said, for this moment. And again, one of the things I see, they never mention God at all in this. It says, Moses brought them up out of the land of Egypt. Moses did all of this. No, Moses didn't do any of it. God called Moses. God sent Moses didn't even want to go. I mean, he had spent 40 years there in the wilderness with his father-in-law and with a family there. And I believe he was quite content to stay there. God called him and sent him back. And he said, well, I can't speak. He's making all kinds of excuses. He didn't want to go. Don't blame it on Moses. But that's what they did. Moses brought it up out of the land of Egypt. And we don't know what's happened to him. So, make us gods and we can move on. And Aaron caved in to them, made them a golden calf. There's lessons in that. And the golden calf, because golden calf keeps cropping up. We see it here. They must have picked it up from Egypt, I believe, is the understanding. It was one of the gods that they worshiped there. Crops up here. We see when the rebellion of the kingdom of Israel after the death of Solomon, his son Rehoboam became king, and the rebellion and the northern 10 tribes separated under Jeroboam. Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who did cause Israel to sin. And what was his sin? He made golden calves. He said, these be your gods. This is where you worship up here. You don't go back down to Jerusalem anymore. So it crops up again. This false worship we see constantly crop. There's nothing new. Satan, our adversary, doesn't have to come up with a new plan because the old one keeps working very well. Human nature being what it is, human nature not changing, the way he works upon human nature continues to work. Now the idea, the concept of a golden calf, it may make different manifestations. Jesus talked about there in Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, he says, you can't serve two gods. You can't serve God and mammon, worldly gain. And it seems like there's one thing that in Scripture and in human history, that if there's any one thing that epitomizes our concept of worldly gain, it's gold. You retire, what do they give you? Gold watch. Wasn't that the tradition? Everybody talk about retiring, get a gold watch. Well, I retired from secular work. I'm not retired from preaching. Lord willing, I'll be preaching until the Lord comes back. I have no desire or plans to retire from preaching, but that's in the Lord's hands. He'll deal with that and deal with me according to his plan and purpose. But gold has come to epitomize success, achievement, position in this world, and the material gain of this world. It talks about the love of money is the root of all evil. Not the money itself, but the greed, the desire to obtain is at the root of all evil, even in worship. And so we see a golden calf that was made. And the sad thing is that man left to himself will do this every time. Understand that. Man left to himself, apart from the grace of God, will do this every time. That's the reason it keeps cropping up. The reason we find so many references in the Scripture. Jesus said that, no man can serve two masters. You cannot serve God and mammon. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. God knows you have need of these things. And what was the first two things on that list? Or at least one of the is food and rain. Food and drink. Now he didn't mention drink, but they kind of go together. Mentioned food and raiment in particular there. He said, God knows you have need of these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and these things will be added to you. Your needs will be met. Anyway. In John the 4th chapter, Jesus speaking to the Samaritan woman there at the well, said, true worship. Worship God in spirit and in truth. True worship. But in Matthew, the 15th chapter, he had warned about vain worship. They do worship me in vain. He said, well did Isaiah prophesy of you. I mean, it was a problem in Isaiah's day. It was a problem before Isaiah's day. It was a problem in Jesus' day. It's a problem today. He said, you draw nigh to me with your lips. Now let me turn over there. Matthew 15. You're still in Matthew 24, not too far. Matthew 15, verse 7 and 9 through 9. Said, ye hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, this people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and they honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. And so we see the human reasoning, the thinking and all coming into play here. Talk about, God loves us and we love him, we love the Lord. He said, well, if you love me, then keep my commandments. But instead of doing that, what they're teaching is the commandments of men. They give human reasoning a higher priority and preference over the things that God has said. You know, that's what Satan came to Eve there in the garden. Hath God said? Did he really say that? Is that what he meant? How many times have we heard some variation of that thought? We talk about the things of God and what the scripture teaches, and this is how we're to worship him, this is what we're to do. Is that what he really meant? Which translation are you using? Mine doesn't say that. Hath God said? Then we see false worship. 2 Timothy. See, how about true worship and vain worship? Talks about false worship. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 13. Says, but evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. See, there's a warning. You know, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. The evil men, seducers, getting worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Need to be careful that we do not replace the things that God has given us. Sunday school this morning, we was talking about the tabernacle and the order of march and different things, and how the tabernacle was disassembled and the pieces of it were carried, and there was those things he referred to as the holy things. The things of God that he's given, they're holy things. They're not to be profaned. They're not to be replaced and have something else substituted for them. The holy things of God are not to be used for vain and profane activities and so on. Second tip, he says, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned. Continue. You have need of patience. You need to just keep on keeping on. You see, continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Because there is a danger. The children of Israel had learned some things. They'd been assured of some things, but how quickly they forgot. I think one of the problems we have, we've taken for granted that people know. This church is not unique in this. I believe that we can see this all over. But there was a time, maybe 30 years ago, 40 years ago, this church was full. There was a lot of young people in it. Had Sunday school classes full. Those young people are adults now. Where are they? Did we assume that they knew some things? They'd been taught. We don't need to take for granted. Need to continue. It said, from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. What is Scripture is? Not the philosophies of men. Not these religious teachers in the world that people think so highly of. You know, I don't know how many times books have been recommended to us by people that are supposedly Christians, and these are supposedly Christian books, and they are trash. Not that they use trashy words necessarily, but the whole philosophy and the way they present God and everything is unscriptural. It's ungodly. And yet, people who profess to be Christians are promoting it as though, boy, this is great. You need to read this. You come back to them, hand back to them, and say, no, that's no good. They say, what's wrong with it? I read it. I didn't find anything wrong with it. That's scary. What is profitable? Scripture. If you want to know how to raise your kids, read the Scriptures. If you want to know how to conduct yourself, read the Scripture. Why go somewhere else? You've got the perfect resource right here. It's the only one you need. The man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. If there's anything worth doing that you're supposed to be doing, you'll find it right here. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. For the time will come. What did he tell you? Continue. The time will come when people will feel that the Lord tarries. He's delayed his return. He's not coming back. Time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. but after their own lust. The fleshly, their fleshly understanding, the senses, walking by sight, not by faith, and so on and so forth. After their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. As they went to Aaron and said, now, you make us gods. And he did what they told him to do. He was one of them that died in the wilderness too. Well, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned to fables. Fables. I mean, if you don't have the truth, if you're not going to receive the truth, if you're not going to believe the truth and follow it, what's left? Whatever else you may find, whatever else you might attach yourself to, it's fables, it's foolishness, it's idolatry. And call it what you will, but bottom line, it's idolatry. Idol worship. Galatians chapter 4. Verses 8 and 9. It said, how be it then, when you knew not God, you did service unto them which by nature are no gods. You know, it's kind of like the children of Israel when they was in bondage in Egypt. They did service there in Egypt. God brought them out. Here they come at Mount Sinai. And they've forgotten all about it. 40 days with nothing to do. And they forgot all about God, all the things that he did. They attributed all to Moses. He said, before the Lord saved you, you did service to them which by nature are no gods. He said, but now, after that you have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage? He talks about there, you know, in comparison to the truth, the philosophies of men, the things of this world, said they're weak and beggarly. Why do you want to return to that? He's questioning now. Weak and beggarly elements. You cannot serve God and mammon. You cannot have it your way and be pleasing to God. One of the things I see there, that after they've made that golden calf, and Aaron, now he really got into the spirit of things here. Verse 5, and when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, talking about the golden calf. And Aaron made proclamation, said, tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. It wasn't to the Lord. Paul says there in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, the things that the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons, not to God. To devils, not to God. We ought not to think that God is pleasing and accepts such worship. In verse 6, and so they rose up early on the morrow, and they offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. You know, they think they can appease God. Brought burnt offerings and peace offerings. And when they had finished that, said they sat down to eat, drink, and they rose up to play. God's really pleased with that. And so we see today, people profess to believe in God and to be worshiping God, but the majority of Christian churches, if you observe, are very worldly. It is very difficult to go in and really see that much difference between what is happening in church and what is happening in the world. And instead of being a separated people and separating and coming apart from the world, they're just bringing the world in and it's incorporated into everything that they're doing. We see worldly music, worldly dress, worldly ideas for doctrine. You know, I was surprised when talking about gold and some of these different things, and how Aaron went along and said, to heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And if you're willing to compromise and to go along, and actually, somebody once said the best way to be a leader is see what direction everybody's going in and jump out in front of them. Now you're a leader. Scripture talks about with feigned words making merchandise of you. Every once in a while I see these things online and these lists of different things. You kind of go through them. One of them was talking about preachers, how much money they make. Do you realize that some of the wealthiest men in the world preachers? Gates with Microsoft, he is junior league compared to some of these guys. I was amazed. $400 million, $500 million, billions of dollars, some of these preachers are worth. And some of the wealthiest of them are in some of the poorest countries in the world. In Africa, Sierra Leone, and different places like that. Some of the poorest places in the world, and these preachers are some of the wealthiest men in the world, and they've gotten wealthy off the poorest people in the world. Talk about making merchandise of you. It is unreal. And so as we observe this, and obviously the deterioration is seen in the description here into our behavior, they sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. The gratification of the fleshly desires. And as we've said, this is seen in association with the worship itself, the worldly music, the worldly dress, the party celebration mentality. And if that's what they're going to do for worship, what do they do the rest of the week? It carries over into their worldly lifestyle. No restraint, no regard to what is pleasing to God or what is not pleasing to God. If they really thought about what they was doing and whether or not it was pleasing to God, they wouldn't be doing it. But there's, you know, that's one of the things, Romans 1:28, he said, you know, they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, in their understanding. Romans 1:28, let me quote that accurately. Romans 1. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. That is, they're not pleasing to Him. And it's not really in our best interest. But being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whispers, backbiters. We preached about that this morning, didn't we? These things occur in the church, and there's so much strife and confusion and things in the churches. Why? Where does this come from? They did not like to retain God in their knowledge. There's no restraint. Haters of God. Despiteful. See, they don't want to retain the knowledge. You mention God, they're going to get upset. Well, God says this, they're going to get upset. This is what God says in His Word. They'll get upset. They don't want to hear that. Proud boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. What's one of the commandments, children? Honor thy father and thy mother. See, that pertains to God, and they don't want to remember those things. There was a judge who had the Ten Commandments inscribed in stone, placed out in front of the courthouse. You know, people got mad, went to court, forced them to remove it. Do not want to retain God in their knowledge. That's the society that we're living in. But it's not all out there. Many of the churches, it's in here. See, we're not under law. We need those Ten Commandments. We don't need to teach the Ten Commandments anymore. We're not under law. We're under grace. What do they mean by that? We can go do anything we want to. Without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affections, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God and they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. What a summation of our society. Paul here describes the degeneration from a peak of knowing, and I believe by inference, worshiping God, the true God, to a complete rejection, not only of God, but also of any moral standard or restraints that might be associated with God, even in worship. But as we said, if you take that out, what is there left to worship? Worship of what? Now Jesus said to the Samaritan woman, said, you worship you know not what. I'm afraid that most of the people who claim to be Christians today and come to church and they sing and they pray and they have no idea what they worship. Paul said to the Greeks there in Athens, I want to declare unto you the unknown God, because He's unknown. The true God is unknown. They're religious. He said, I perceive you're religious. I perceive you're too religious. You're too superstitious. People do this and they think that they're worshiping and serving God. How sad. But one thing we can take from this too, in their sin and rebellion, God meted out both judgment and mercy, condemnation and redemption. He did not condone their sin, He condemned it. He judged it. He will not condone anyone's sin. He condemns it. He judges it. But He also offers mercy and redemption at the same time. We can find forgiveness and reconciliation with God, but only through Jesus Christ, His Son. Burnt offerings, peace offerings, will do no good. You have to come through His Son. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. He's the only access we have to the Father. He said in John 3:6-37, all that the Father giveth me will come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. So there is a way open for us to have forgiveness of sin, to have reconciliation, be reconciled to God, to have peace with God, and that's through the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we're willing to come to Him, seek God through Him, we shall find Him. Him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. And that is the thought I want to leave you with then this evening. All those that will come to Him, they'll turn from their wicked ways, acknowledge God, lean not to thine own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. You have need of patience. We need God to give us the grace and strength that we might keep on keeping on and not grow weary in well-doing and doing the right thing, because in due season. Now, it might seem to us that that season has been due a long time ago. And we look around and see this world and think, man, that judgment has been due for a long time. Why doesn't God come back and judge this world? Well, Paul said there, or Peter said, we need to account that the long suffering of God is salvation to us. God is not slack concerning His promise. He is not going to tarry. He's going to be right on time. We just need to learn to be patient and wait on Him and to be faithful in the things He's given us to do, and to keep on keeping on till He does. Let us stand together now.